The views and opinions expressed on the Veterans in Politics radio show and podcast are those of the guests and hosts and do not necessarily reflect those of Vegas AllNet Radio, its affiliates, or its parent company.
This is Steve Sanson and Jim Jonas with Veterans in Politics. Before we get into the rants, I just want to announce today's guest is Vern. What's that last name, Jim?
I'm not sure.
Winchy. There we go. I just want to make sure everybody's on the same page so we won't mess up Mr. Winchy's last name. He is the a Republican candidate for United States President, and we're going to be talking to him very shortly. But without further ado, Jim, what's going on? You have any rants?
Yeah, actually, since we have a Republican candidate for president on the air, I watched the Republican presidential debate. So I wanted to just make this real brief. So I broke down what I thought of each one of the performances. I think Ron Paul came across, honestly, as being out of touch, too out of touch with the mainstream to be president. But I think he should stay involved. I think he's good for the country. He gets politicians to think outside the box. Former governor of Utah, Huntsman, he's a Democrat. I don't know why he's running. Pawlenty came across as a powder, so I'm pretty sure after today's straw poll, he'll be done. Herman Cain came across to me as he's a comedian. Michelle Bachmann, she's too inexperienced, has a good message. She should keep it up, and I'll look at her again in 2016. Newt Gingrich, very smart, keep giving speeches. Rick Santorum, outside the mainstream to get elected as president. Mitt Romney's getting better. The ones that weren't there, Rick Perry and Sarah Palin. Rick Perry, governor of Texas. It's not that difficult to be a Republican governor of Texas because most of the Democrats in the legislature in Texas are actual Republicans anyway. So I'm not exactly sure how he would perform as president when you have real partisanship in Washington, D.C. Bush. Bush was a former governor as well. You know, he did pretty good his first term, second term not so well when they had real partisanship, so I'm not so sure about Rick Perry. Sarah Palin, she wasn't there, but she showed up at the Iowa barbecue or whatever. she likes the attention as long as it's positive, and my advice to her is the same. Keep giving speeches.
Wow, Jim, you really criticize these presidential candidates, huh?
Well, I mean, here's the thing. if you're gonna run for president, you're gonna be criticized a lot, and it's how you handle that criticism and how you can lead that's gonna make you an effective or ineffective president. So, right. I mean, if you can't handle criticism from Jim Jonas, how do you think you're gonna handle criticism from the mainstream public?
You know, speaking of criticism, you know, the Veterans in Politics is doing their first annual Veterans in Politics Ball at the Plaza, help with the revitalization of downtown and help with the renovation of the Plaza. And we have three guest speakers. One represent the city, one represent the federal government, the other one represent the state. And these three guest speakers are all elected officials. One represent the Independent Party, one represent the Democrat Party, and one represent the Republican Party. So you got Las Vegas Mayor Carolyn Goodman, Lieutenant Governor Brian Krolicki, and Congresswoman Shelley Berkley. Now, these flyers of invitation have went out, a lot of them went out, and you should see the criticism on that. I mean, why are you having Shelley Berkley? Why are you having Brian Krolicki? Why isn't it all Republican? Why isn't it all Democrats? What's wrong with these people? Well, don't they know Veterans in Politics is a nonpartisan group, and we have to be in touch with all the political parties? That's the only way you become nonpartisan, right? If you're in touch with all the political parties, isn't that right?
Very true.
And aren't you supposed to put America first and party second? Isn't that how it's supposed to work?
Yeah, that's exactly how it's supposed to work. That's why I found it interesting. That's why I said what I said about Rick Perry, is because, you know, it's when President Bush, former President Bush, Bush Jr., George W. Bush, to be clear, became president, everybody said, oh, he ran Texas, you know, he was governor of, you know, one of the largest states, and he was a good executive, and blah, 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 he got all this stuff passed. Well, the thing is, yeah, he did get a lot of stuff passed.
Right.
But most Democrats in Texas, if you took a national poll on their ideology, are pretty much mainstream Republicans.
Right.
So I just don't see where – I just honestly don't see where Rick Perry is going to be able to get up in Washington, D.C., where there's just this bitter partisanship. And it frustrates me that there is, but you know what? That's the fact of life.
You know what I think? I think that if these elected officials was to come to a meeting of the minds and start thinking about the American people at large and stop thinking about just the minority – affiliation of their political party and what those folks want, I think we'll probably be in a better place, and I think we'll probably get a lot done. And you know, this Veterans in Politics ball, it'll be the first political ball that represents everybody.
Right.
Not just a political party. Everybody. And I think we need to have more of that. I really do think that these folks out there that are so pro-party, I think their ideology is so out of whack and so out of touch with the American public, it's pathetic. I think that they need to start thinking about the American people as a whole and know that we all have differences. We all come from a different place. But we all need to reach a compromise to get this country moving. And we it's like mediation in court. The defense have to move forward and the plaintiff have to move forward. That's the only way you're going to get something done, or else you're going to be at a stalemate fighting each other over nothing.
Exactly. You know, the father of our country, George Washington, the first president, actually said that one of the downfalls eventually could be for this nation is if you formed political parties. He was not a fan of that because he said what's going to end up happening is that your loyalty eventually is going to go to the party, not to the country. And we're talking 1786 here. And so he comes up with this, and now it's 2011, and you and I are talking about the same thing. So I think George Washington was a pretty smart guy on that one. It's disappointing, but it's a fact of life. Here's my spin on it, is that for individuals that think that they can't change that, you can change it. When I was in one of my political science classes, when I was getting my bachelor's degree, one of the my professor said, you know, the system works. It actually does. If you're willing to do the groundwork, you're willing to get out in the streets and yell enough, you know, it's going to work. So I think people need to mobilize, and not just the Tea Party. I mean, the Tea Party has done a very good job of mobilizing individuals, but that's only one side of the coin.
Right.
I would like to see other people mobilize instead of, you know, kind of throwing their hands up in the air and saying, I don't know, I'm not a politician, I can't really do nothing about this. You know, get active.
Right.
Do things. I mean, you're a perfect example of when I first met you, the first thing you told me was, Jim, if you're going to actually ever get anywhere or feel comfortable about anything because I see your passion, you need to get involved.
Mm-hmm.
And you're the main reason why I got involved. You brought me into this process, so I want to thank you for that.
I appreciate
and,
that.
And I want to encourage others to do that. If you don't think there's nothing that can be done, don't just give up. I mean, there's always something you can do.
And you know something? If anybody ever been in battle and been on the combat zone, you're not worried about who right. is with what political party.
Right.
You just want to know that that person is a American citizen that has your back. And even if that person is not American citizen, because there's some military folks that are serving in the military that are actually not an American citizen, but here legally, right. that they have your back. And that's all it is, that make sure folks have your back. Because I have a lot of friends on different sides of the aisle, and I'm talking independent American Party as well, libertarians, and Green Party folks. You know, I don't discriminate because somebody's with a different party. And I think I think that's a form of discrimination. I really do. Because if you're a Republican or if you're a Democrat or if you're a libertarian, I don't want to talk to you because your ideologies are different. No, that's what this country's founded on, different ideologies, but it's also founded on folks working together to reach a common goal. And the common goal is to make America prosperous. Isn't that the goal, to make America prosperous?
Absolutely. I'm going to take this. I'm going to take this a step further on that. You know, we complain a lot about ideology, and we just did, right? You know, I don't think that just because you're a Republican, you should automatically, you know, blow someone off who has a different idea. Let's discuss it. You know, and we can come to a compromise, and I think that would be great for the nation. However, now with the debt crisis being the way it is, the thing I get frustrated with some voters, and I've heard this from elected officials, that say, you know, we hear politicians on both sides of the aisle talk about we need mutual sacrifice. Right. You know, we're all going to have to give something up to make this work.
Right.
So I was talking to a congressman, not from this state, but from another state, and we were talking about it, and he said, you know, I'm a Republican, and I went to a town hall meeting with several senior citizens, and when I started talking about we need to revamp Social Security, we need to revamp Medicare, we need to look at everything, the Defense Department, everything has to be on the table. He said, you know what, I almost didn't get out of there alive, because these citizens are going, wait a minute, I depend on this program, I depend on this program. So when you start talking about cutting individual programs, then the citizens, the voters, get upset. And unfortunately, the active voters are the ones that go to these meetings. So as a congressman or a senator, whether you agree with that or not, I mean, you're trying to keep your job, right?
Right.
You want to get reelected. If you say that, hey, we need to rework this or that, and half the room is ready to lynch you, are you really going to go to bat for revamp those programs?
Right.
And so my thing is that, you know, we can blame politicians, but we also have to blame ourselves a little bit. So get involved and let's talk about mutual sacrifice.
Exactly.
You know, if you're willing to, if you won't, as an individual, as a voter, sacrifice a little bit for another voter, you can't get upset with the politician that's trying to keep his job.
Well, yeah. Is that it for the rants?
Yeah.
Oh, I got a PBS. I just want to let folks know that if you received the email from me on my personal email address, DW Sanson, don't click on the link because apparently my email address has been compromised. Apparently I'm sending out Viagra and pornographic materials, and I don't send out any Viagra, that's for doggone sure. And as far as pornographic materials, I only send them to people I know if I do choose to send them. But I don't send them anyway, so don't. I don't want to hear anybody say that Steve Sanson sent out pornographic materials, because I don't. Unless it's my arms and I worked out on them and they look big, and other than that, no. Anyways, let's take a commercial break. This is Steve Sanson and Jim Jonas with Veterans in Politics. We'll be back momentarily with Vern Winchy. The Republican candidate for United States President. Vern, if you're listening, don't get upset with me. We'll be right back.
Hey, listen up. If you're a military veteran, if you're related to a veteran, or if you know a veteran, you'll enjoy the Veterans Reporter radio show every Thursday from 8 p.m. to 9 p.m. with me. I'm your host, Chuck N. Baker. Every week, we will explore veterans' issues and we'll have guests who will talk about topics of interest to and about the veterans community. And if you don't listen, you'll have to give me 20 push-ups.
Veterans in Politics' first annual VIP ball will be held at the Plaza Hotel and Casino in downtown Las Vegas on Saturday, October 15th at 5:30 p.m. Join us for a VIP reception, dinner, and dancing with special guest speaker, United States Congresswoman Shelley Berkley. Other invited guest speakers will include Nevada Lieutenant Governor Brian Kroelke and Las Vegas Mayor Carolyn Goodman. Together, we are moving veterans forward in Nevada. For tickets and sponsorships, call 702-813-8356 or visit our website at www.veteransinpolitics.com.
9711 Southeastern Avenue, Suite H1 is the place to be. Get yourself a treat. Come to M&Y Snowballs to beat the heat. More than 40 regular flavors, 8 sugar-free flavors, or your choice of 2 cream flavors. Stuff your snowball with soft-serve ice cream for a dollar more. We have smoothies, soft drinks, cheese and nachos, and even more. New Orleans original flavor, all of which you can savor. We hope to see you there.
This public service announcement is brought to you by Veterans in Politics International. The Veterans in Politics mission is to teach, educate, organize, and awaken our veterans and their families to select, support, and vote intelligently for a better world and to protect ourselves from our own governments and a culture of corruption and to be the political voice for those in other groups that do not have one.
There are too many homeless veterans and more help is needed from the VA. Every veteran service organization post should adopt a local homeless veteran.
The funding of VA medical centers is inadequate and building a VA hospital in Southern Nevada is moving at a slow pace. The budget has been flatlined for too many years. The VA is too quick to deny claims and too slow to help veterans gather records in support of claims.
Local politicians ignore veterans and their issues. They perceive a lack of organization among their local veterans and that it won't hurt them at election time. Veterans too often vote party, not veteran issues. All veterans should vote in every election.
The news media give an adequate coverage to veteran issues and events. You must send letters to the editor and voice this concern.
Please contact your members of Congress and Senate and urge them to co-sponsor key legislation in supporting our veterans.
Please support Veterans in Politics. And to get more information, go to www.veteransinpolitics.com.
Well, we're back. This is Steve Sanson, Jim Jones with Veterans in Politics, and we have live on the horn. I believe this candidate's from Chicago, but I'm not sure. We have Vern Winchy, who's the Republican candidate for United States President. Vern, how you doing, sir?
I am doing good, Sam. How are you?
I'm doing real good. Is Chicago your hometown? Is that correct?
No, just in Texas.
Texas! Wow, you and Rick Perry going for the same seat. Imagine that.
Well, know a lot about Rick Perry. He's been the governor here for, I don't know, I think it's 10 years in my recollection.
So but before we get into your bio, how does Rick Perry jump in the race? How does that affect the whole Republican presidential format, so to speak?
Well, it depends on how he plays out. I was in the 2008 campaign with Fred Thompson, and people are comparing him in some respects to Fred Thompson. I'm not sure I'd make the same comparison because Fred Thompson was, I don't think, was personally motivated to be president that much. Rick Perry, I believe, is. But like most of the pundits are saying, he will affect Michelle Bachmann probably more than anyone because they draw from some of the same vote, but a difference that the pundits, in my opinion, aren't picking up is Perry is more of an establishment candidate. He's been in office for 26 straight years, so he has more of that aura about him than Michelle Bachmann does, who's pretty much a fighter for her cause and has her own ideology. So how that plays out will depend a lot on Governor Perry.
Hey, all right, Vern, could you tell us a little bit about yourself, a little background?
I grew up in a small town of 250 people called MacDade, Texas. in Central Texas, about 35 miles from Austin. My father was a handyman at a brick plant. My mother worked at a laundry. Neither got a high school education, but my mother saw the value of education and encouraged me to go to the University of Texas. And so I have a degree, a BBA degree in there in accounting and an MBA in management. I'm also a certified public accountant, hold a certificate. I came to Houston and worked for some big eight CPA firms, and then ultimately at age 29 started my own business in residential construction, and I've had that business now for 35 years. I'm Houston's oldest, third oldest residential contractor.
Oh, very cool. Go ahead, Jim.
Hey, Vern, so well, welcome on the show.
Oh, Jim.
And then the thing I wanted to ask you just real quick, did you listen to my rant?
I sure did, and I agreed with, I'd say, much of it. The bipartisan nature is the one, of course, that a Republican candidate has a much harder time with than you probably do. But on issues that are important to you and really in a lot of ways important to all Americans, such as defense, such as finances, the issue of finances should be the same for everyone. I have financial background and managed a business like you have for many, many years. And, you know, economic principles are economic principles, and the Republicans are strongly right on this one. You can't spend your way into prosperity. And for some reason, the Democrat Party has not picked up on that. Paul Krugman had an article this morning that just kind of slayed me. He said, well, we can't worry about the long term. We have to only worry about the short term. The way I was raised, that's called immaturity.
Yeah, well, from my standpoint, Paul Krugman, the only time I read Paul Krugman is if I want a good laugh anyway.
But you said that the finance, you said finances should represent everybody, correct? Is that
everybody wants to be more prosperous. You know, there's an article in Wall Street Journal, I think it was Peggy Noonan, made the comment that, you know, dependency doesn't create gratitude; it creates anger.
So why did the House and the Senate, for that matter, had such a problem with the government's finances in the past several months? This year alone, they were going to delay payment of veterans benefits and active duty military pay, and then they reached some type of compromise with that after I don't know how many hours of discussion, and then they had a problem with the debt ceiling. So if finance represents everybody, how come they have a tough time agreeing?
Well, the thing is, and I think I don't know of any Republican that believe that the debt ceiling shouldn't be increased to a level to at least pay current Social Security recipients, Medicare recipients, and veterans, and obviously necessary elements of the military, because that's a security issue. A lot of times the liberals bring that up as a lever. Oh, well, we're going to, you know, push grandma over a cliff, or we're going to cut off the veterans that are in hospitals. They use that as a leverage point. I don't know of any Republican or any conservative that I know of that does not believe the government should first pay its interest on its debt, then pay whatever notes that are due, then pay anything regarding security and retirees and Social Security and Medicare. And what the Republicans were trying to do is to say, after that, let the voters decide. Let the voters put pressure on the politicians to decide after that, what do we spend it on?
Well, I want you to educate me on this aspect, because last week, socialized medicine was brought up to me and Jim off air, and a person was asking us about our beliefs and our philosophy on socialized medicine. What's yours on socialized medicine, and do you believe that these pharmacies out there are just raping the American public as far as giving them medication for everything instead of treating the problem? Because medication is basically a Band-Aid. And then when you hear other countries are finding the cure for this and finding the cure for that, and we're not. And then when you hear in other countries like Canada and Mexico have the same prescription drugs for four times cheaper than what is sold here in America. Are these pharmaceutical companies killing the American public's pocketbook?
Well, it's Sam, it's a double hit. The government requires such stringent procedures for a drug to be brought to market. It costs millions or tens of millions of dollars in about 6 or 7 years to bring a drug to market. And then if somebody's dying of a disease and said, well, look, I don't mind the drug, maybe it's not perfect, but I'm going to die anyway, they don't even allow the pharmaceuticals to sell it. So what the pharmaceuticals do then, after spending all of that R&D money over 7 years, they just stick it to the public any way they can. And my argument should be, let the public decide if there's a risk to these. Let people who test these drugs decide what the risk level is. And the public, in some ways, should be allowed to make that decision. I'm a big believer in free market to solve all of the socialized medicine problems. If you think about it, your employer pays for the medical care, or the government pays for the medical care. I mean, what kind of organization would exist when the purchaser didn't discipline the producer by price? Everything is regulated.
You know,
and if you bring it like medical savings accounts would be, of course, a great thing as a good start. Get the government out of it.
You know something, Vern, and there's another thing I wanted to bring up too, because I hear a lot of stuff and a lot of criticism, and I had a judge brought this to my attention, okay, and he was saying, why is it that so many of the active duty military are Republicans? And he was asking me why that is, and my philosophy is because that Republicans like to take a front run on going into countries and doing what's right, and they like more of an action, where Democrats are more in turn of diplomacy and after diplomacy, and Republicans are more stronger in that area, would go to war if need be. But then he also said, then why is it that Republicans don't support veterans when they come out, such as what they might call socialized programs, such as Veterans Court and treatment for PTSD and help with the homeless veterans when they come out and retraining veterans that who was a sniper in the military and coming to be a civilian now might not have a job out there for a sniper, so they have to retrain in some type of civilian type job. So he wanted to know, why is it that Republicans don't support social programs for veterans when they come out?
Well, you know, that's an interesting point, and you know, I had never thought of that before until you just mentioned it. But it's probably a little bit of a reflex, and in my opinion, a very, very bad reflex on the part of conservatives. Conservatives basically believe people should be self-sufficient. Now, I personally believe, and I believe this strongly, and that is a veteran should be given high priority in any socialized payment, even over seniors and even over Medicare people, because these people have... You know, they kick in doors in Afghanistan and don't know who's on the other side and whether it's the kid strapped with a bomb or whatever. Our military people today have to be so much more skilled. Psychologists, I mean, it's incredible compared to, you know, when I was in the military many, many years ago. And if they don't support those programs, they certainly should. And that's one thing I would guarantee if I became president, is that veterans would be given top first priority. A little add to that, if you wonder this debt ceiling thing, basically they set up a commission where there's going to be, I don't know, a number of people who make a decision in 3 months as to whether they can change the amount of debt, and if not, something automatically triggers. And the thing that upset Republicans most is Defense Department cuts are the biggest thing that will be automatically cut if they don't reach a deal. And in my understanding, it's the Democrat Party that set that up so that they would have pressure on Republicans to do essentially what they wanted to do on the debt. To me, that's horrifying, because security is the first job of any government. After that, everything is second.
Well, Vern, I'm pretty familiar with what you're talking about. You're talking about the Super 12 Commission, where
that's correct.
You have six Republicans And then you have six Democrats. And Newt Gingrich actually brought that up as being the worst idea he's ever heard of, which is one of the few things that I agree with him on in the debate. Actually, I agree with Newt on a lot of things. I just didn't think he handled the debate well. But with that being said, you know, the counter-argument, I'm just playing devil's advocate here. Sure. I heard a study that we are paying, our defense budget right now is $250 billion a year more than it was in 1984 with Ronald Reagan when he was doing his massive buildup during the Cold War. And a lot of people are concerned that why are we spending $250 billion more than we did back then? And this isn't just dollars. This is per capita of GDP. Yes, correct.
The percent of GDP has gone down, to my understanding, and you may be more knowledgeable on that issue than I am. But as I understand it, ever since the Clinton years, which we essentially got a peace dividend because there was no wars, the defense budget has dropped tremendously. And I think Bush may have built it up some, but it's never been back where it was in the early 90s. And I could be incorrect on that.
Well, Vern, and here's the thing. I'm right with you on your philosophy. You and I are not disagreeing on philosophy that the military and veterans obviously should be taken care of first. I think the counter argument that a lot of Democrats make, and there's some, a little bit of validity to it, and I'm sure most of my Republican friends aren't going to like me saying that. It's that we're in the middle of a crisis right now. And if Republicans come to the table and they just say absolutely nothing can be cut from the defense budget, then what's to incentivize the Democrats on the other side to cut some of the entitlement spending? And I think there are some ways in which you could cut the Defense Department and not hurt the pay of veterans. If I've always felt that, you know, if you want to come to the negotiating table, why don't you put that out there first and then tell the Democrats, okay, this is what we've offered. Now, what are you going to do? What would you do if you were in that situation?
I would agree, and apologize for interrupting, but I would agree with you 100%. And this is my approach to cutting government back just in total. People always approach the big dollars. I've worked in businesses where you sit around a table and decide how you're going to cut the cost of a product. And the key to cutting a cost of anything is in the details. And your point with the Defense Department would be very good, and that is the people in the Defense Department know where there's a lot of waste or something that's against whatever the mission of the country is, and they could just come up with a long list of it. Military base closings, which happened a few years ago, and come up with a long list and present it to the Democrats and say, okay, what do you want to cut? I would agree with that 100%.
Hey, Vern, we're going to take a commercial, and we come right back to you, so don't hang up your phone, okay?
All righty.
This is Steve Sands and Jim Jones for Veterans in Politics. Don't go away, folks. We'll be back with Vern Winchie, who is the Republican candidate for United States President.
Veterans in Politics' first annual VIP ball will be held at the Plaza Hotel and Casino in downtown Las Vegas on Saturday, October 15th at 5:30 p.m. Join us for a VIP reception, dinner, and dancing with special guest speaker, United States Congresswoman Shelley Berkley. Other invited guest speakers will include Nevada Lieutenant Governor Brian Kolicki and Las Vegas Mayor Carolyn Goodman. Together, we are moving veterans forward in Nevada. For tickets and sponsorships, call 702-813-8356 or visit our website at www.veteransinpolitics.com.
Veterans in Politics takes a proactive approach to provide you, the veteran, with the political voice for which you fought and served.
Veterans in Politics is becoming the premier veteran organization of the 21st century, with political candidate interviews, insight, and endorsements.
Public speaking engagements in support of American values.
Radio shows to keep you updated on the latest in veteran and military support operations.
Providing job placement and business support.
Go to veteransinpolitics.com today and do your part in defending liberty.
Hey, listen up. If you're a military veteran, if you're related to a veteran, or if you know a veteran, you'll enjoy the Veterans Reporter radio show every Thursday from 8 p.m. to 9 p.m. with me. I'm your host, Chuck N. Baker. Every week, We will explore veterans' issues and we'll have guests who will talk about topics of interest to and about the veterans community. And if you don't listen, you'll have to give me 20 push-ups.
Americans have been fooled by politicians about illegal immigration. They make you think that if you bring up this topic, you are a racist. Did you know that America is the only country on this planet that does not enforce its federal immigration laws? For the fear of being called a racist, I am for legal immigration. I was born on the island of Jamaica, became an American citizen, served 12 years in the U.S. military, served in Desert Storm, and received a Presidential Unit Citation, National Defense Medal, and Marine Corps Commendation. Our immigration laws serve a purpose. I understand that this country was founded on immigration, but there is a wrong way and a right way. I'm here to tell you that illegal immigration is breaking our federal laws. Why don't you call me a racist? This is Steve Sansom.
Are you a business owner struggling during these economic times? Please listen up. How would you like to put your business and services in front of every resident and business in the Las Vegas Valley for less than a penny per home? Yes, that's right. I said less than 1 cent per home and business. And how would you like to have a dynamic and exciting online presence with the major search engines? How about an online video for your business and a fully optimized website with absolutely no setup fee? Hi, my name is George. If you are interested in these and other services that can make your phone ring with clients and prospects, then call me at 702-296-8394. Just call George at 702-296-8394. Thank you.
What are you doing online?
I'm checking out the belly dance class we took last week.
Where is it at?
TakeBackYourBelly.com.
That's right.
We worked our arms.
We worked our abs.
We worked so hard
and had a blast. No matter what, your shape or size, come belly dance, you'll be surprised.
For class schedule and location, log on to TakeBackYourBelly.com or call 219-3151.
This is Steve Sasson. Steve Sasson and Chip Jonas with Veterans in Politics. And we have Vern Winchy on the horn, Republican candidate running for United States President. Vern, we're going to treat you as a hostile guest since you hung up the phone.
Uh-oh.
Hostile guest.
No hostile here.
Go ahead, Jim.
Hey, Vern. one of the main questions I wanted to ask you was, number one, why did you decide to run for president? And two, with limited name recognition, what a lot of and I'm not trying to be disrespectful here, but a lot of candidates run for president, and it's not because they feel as though necessarily they're going to be able to become president, but what they want to do is there's a single message that they want to get out there, and they want to make it a part of the national debate. Is that the situation you're in?
Well, it's twofold. Number one, I've studied the presidency for 40 years, and what's become very clear to me is it's like a chess game, and there's a lot of luck involved. Where you are, when you get in, how much money you have, a whole lot of variables, and until the internet, it was impossible for someone unknown to do well. But if you take Ron Paul's $37 million that he raised last time, and you take somebody like Joe the Plumber, who everybody knew who he was in 24 hours, and those series of events happen, anybody could be president, and I believe that. And at the same time, the percentages, the odds of that are obviously not real good. There's a message that you can convey while you're hoping for that event to occur or trying to make that event to occur. You're interviewing me today is one part of that, archiving a conversation that everybody all over the world can know tomorrow morning if they wanted to.
Right.
But the message that I'm trying to get out specifically is we need people with business experience that know how to make good decisions, have bedrock values, are trained to make good decisions and with a little common sense, and do that to benefit every American. I mean, that should be the goal, I think, of every candidate. Most politicians are lawyers. A very high percent of them are lawyers. Nothing wrong with being a lawyer, but most liberal lawyers are trial lawyers. They're trained never to admit error in a courtroom, and when you get them in Congress, not admitting error is the worst thing you can do. Any business owner knows whatever decision he makes, the next day is going to be changed. So You need people with business background in Congress and in the White House, and a large number of these problems will be solved. They won't be completely solved ever, but we'll have gone a long way towards doing that.
Hey, Vern, you know we're airing from Vegas, right?
Right.
Are you going to get on a national stage and tell the American people not to come to Vegas and spend their money?
Because I'm coming to Vegas at your caucus right after the New Hampshire primary.
You know who's our mayor, right? You know who's our mayor now, right? Oscar Goodman's wife, Carolyn Goodman. And she might not like you very well if you say something like that.
Well, I believe business can be done in a lot of places. Las Vegas has its own reputation, but at the same point in time, it's a free country. And as long as people are operating within the law, hey, that's why we have federalism in 50 states is the way I look at it.
Hey, Vern, so I want to follow up on what you said about...
First off, I just want to say I
agree with you on your philosophy of I'm not a big fan of electing lawyers, especially defense attorneys, because I mean, you said it exactly right. They're told never to admit. And, you know, I mean, it kind of goes back to look what kind of a creep Edwards ended up being. But that's just a personal note. The main question I want to ask you is, you have business experience, so what would differentiate you from Herman Cain, that was a CEO of Godfather's Pizza, and Mitt Romney, that was a venture capitalist? That's their main claim to fame, is that they're talking about, hey, I'm going to bring a business approach.
I'm sorry.
No, go ahead.
What people forget, and I have high respect for Herman Cain and Mitt Romney and their business experience, the difference among myself and those two are, I've run a small business. They've worked for large corporations and made decisions for those. The American public, in many cases, because they don't think it through, believe that if you've run a large organization, your skills must be superior to the 27 million people out there running small businesses. Let me assure you, they are not. And here's the big reason nobody ever thinks about it. Anybody that's been in business more than 10 years, first of all, he's certifiably honest, because he's not going to risk that reputation over a few thousand dollars or whatever. And it's not morality. It's not Christianity. It's just practicality. That's number one. Number two, if he's been in business 10 years, he's outlasted about 90% of the other people that have started businesses. He has to be a good decision maker. He is a certified good decision maker. But if you run Home Depot or any large corporation, you know, you can make a lot of major decisions. As long as you, you know, talk to the right people and schlep it off, you can get another job running an equally large corporation. In fact, that's often done. So the millions of small business owners out there, to me, which is why I called on 6,000 of them in 242 towns in over 100 days in Iowa and New Hampshire in the last campaign, they'd walk in off the street. They're not impressed with the presidential candidate, because they know, hey, if I decide to do that tomorrow, I could do that too, because I'm a decision maker. And that's what Washington needs, is good decision makers. But you rarely see it addressed. Herman Cain and Mitt Romney are great candidates, and it's because they've had to make decisions and make good ones, apparently.
Well, what would you say to somebody, just again playing devil's advocate, with say former President George W. Bush in the second term? A lot of people blame him for turning over just a horrible economy to now President Obama. And you know, George W. Bush had experience as a small business owner in Texas, running different small oil companies, and three of which he bankrupted. And a lot of people would now say that, you know, he played a role in bankrupting the nation. So what would get individuals to think that another small business owner wouldn't do the same?
Well, the difference is this small business owner started out with nothing and has had to make it his own way all his life financially. And there's most of those 27 million small business owners out there have had to do the same. They understood the economics of the situation from a very early age, whereas somebody like George Bush, and he did a lot of good things, and I think he's an honorable Christian man. George Bush did not grow up with the kind of, pressures or tensions that every person in a family worried about paying the mortgage, taking care of the kids, getting college educations for their children, deal with every day. I deal with that every day.
Vern,
I'm like everybody out there.
Vern, you're trying to be nice, and you're following Reagan's 11th commandment, but let's be honest. you had to stand on your own 2 feet. You wouldn't have had Daddy to bail you out if everything went bad.
Well, okay.
Just had to throw that out there. I'm not an anti-Bush guy, but I mean, I'm an honest guy at the same time.
Hey, Vern, let's flip the switch a little bit. Let's talk a little bit about education. Here in Nevada, or Clark County for that matter, I would say, I think the last news article I saw was almost 50% of the schools here had a failing grade about No Child Left Behind. How do you feel about that program, and how are you planning to educate the American public as far as their American kids and the new generation that's going to run this country in the future?
Well, if No Child Left Behind is obviously a failed program, the first thing I would do, and maybe the second thing I would do after eliminating Obamacare, was to eliminate, it would take legislation, the Department of Education.
That
would be a state issue. And the second thing that I would do is...
Hold on, right there, Vern. You said you want to eliminate the Department of Education?
Absolutely.
How would you go about doing that?
Well, if I could get 13 senators together with the Congress, I would ask them, and there's a number of other people, I believe Michelle Bach and certainly Ron Paul would support that, also support that idea, because the federal government has done it for how many years? What have they done? Proof's in the pudding. And the second thing I would encourage, and this is, me, the most important thing, some form of vouchers in education. You take the students in a state, you divide it by the money, tax money available, you give each person a piece of paper and say, go spend it wherever you want to spend it. Entrepreneurs would develop, and you would have to test it, pilot it in a smaller area to learn the little tweaking you need to do, as any business person would do, and then you would have the market determining who's educating their kids. Today, unfortunately, people with money can buy homes in nice areas and their children go to good schools, or they can afford private schools. The poor people, the poor minorities in the inner cities don't have that option, and so they don't get educated, and they have 25% unemployment rate today. You got to get the market involved. That's how our prosperity was developed. It was not developed through government.
Well, Vern, there's a couple of things that you said there that pointed out a couple things to me. Number one, I mean, tell me where I'm wrong here. I don't want to put words in your mouth. So basically, what I'm getting from you is you're pro block grants. Would that be fair to say?
Well, I wouldn't say that. I'm probably against block grants. I would be against. And this may have to be a double-step thing. In other words, reduce the taxes and then eliminate the block grants. I mean, let the states handle their own education. The money would have to be worked out, and that's a little more complex.
Well, by block grants, what I mean is that a block grant is something that the federal government just – the state of Nevada is owed this much money for education.
Right.
So a block grant would be, okay, Governor Sandoval, this is how much money the federal government owes you for education, and you can do what you want with it.
That I would support if it were with no strings.
Right. Well, in Reagan-esque terms, a block grant doesn't have strings. So that's what I was trying to get to.
You're ahead of me on that definition.
No earmarks.
No earmarks. I believe the closer we get to the people, which is the original founders' intention, the better off we are. I mean, it's basic conservative position.
So, Vern, let me follow up on that point real quick. Sorry, Steve. If we need to get closer to the people, and I agree with you on that fundamental philosophy. I mean, I don't normally agree with a Democrat, but I think Tip O'Neill was correct when he said that all politics is local.
Right.
Is this the first time you have run for office?
I ran for office in 2008 as president, and people often ask me, well, why don't you do Congress and then senator and whatever? I've observed through my 40 years of evaluating the political process that the longer one is in a particular office, the more beholden he becomes to all the people there, psychologically and financially. And I have always believed that the later one does this, the less beholden. And I'm a decision maker. I don't have the skills to be a congressman. I respect the skills of somebody, you know, who can scratch backs and this and does it honestly without corrupting themselves. But my skill is as a decision maker, someone who can take facts, use common sense, listen to the people, look at the money, and do like Herman Cain says in his own way, solve problems. But it's pointing everything all the time in the direction that the American people should or want it to go that is necessary. Not just say, well, I need to work on these two or three issues, but you need to help the American people every day on everything.
Hey, Vern, I'm going to switch up a little bit because this has been bothering me for years now. I remember I went to visit U.S. Senator John Ensign in his office in D.C., and my concern was that the Veterans Hospital that we have here in Las Vegas was taking several years longer than the private sector to be built, and the monies to build the Veteran Hospital was tripled than the private sector takes to build a hospital. For example, the Veteran Hospital broke ground here in, I believe it was 2007, something like that. I know they did talk about it in 2004, and the hospital is costing $675 million. Now, we had two other hospitals that was civilian hospitals that was built that took a year and a half to be built that broke ground after this hospital, the VA hospital, broke ground. And they only took a year and a half to be built, and their cost was in the neighborhood of $70 million to $100 million. And they have an OBGYN, and they also bought their land. What the VA hospital's land was donated. Why? And my question was to then-Senator Ensign, why does it take longer for a hospital or anything to be built by the federal government than the private sector? And why is the cost three times to five times the amount for the exact same thing with the federal government instead and the private sector doesn't pay that much money? And he tells me, well, he told me that's how government works. So my answer was, if that's how government works, and you're comfortable with that, then you're part of the problem and not the solution. And we should get rid of everybody that has that same philosophy instead of standing up, want to do something about it. You're the type of guy that's going to sit down and get comfortable with the bullshit. So how do you feel about government taking three, five times longer than the private sector to do the exact same thing and spending five, six times the amount of money to do the exact same thing? Government just get out the hell out the way and let the private sector do everything then? Contract everything out?
Absolutely. In fact, the case here in Houston did a tollway, and they got a private, it's my recollection, they got a private contractor to do it and paid him a bonus for every day he finished it early. And this company made a lot of money because they got it done real early. You basically need to get the government out of doing anything. Name me something the government does well. I mean, the military is probably the thing it does best, to my knowledge. You know, healthcare doesn't work. Education doesn't work. It's because people there or bureaucracies exist for people to keep their job, not a performance for a customer. I say that every citizen needs to be viewed as a customer of the government. And if you say that to people, they look at you kind of strange. Well, why shouldn't they be? The customer's paying for it. Why shouldn't the citizen be a customer?
You know what it is, Vern? I think that if every in the private sector, there's a lot of people take a personal interest in the company that they work for, and they take the time and the money and they look at it as if it was theirs. I think that if every elected official looked at every dollar spent by their municipalities or their state or federal government and pretend that those dollars were their own dollars, I think that we'll come a longer way than we are now.
I completely and 100% agree. And the shorter period of time they stay in office, the closer they are to that sort of attitude. The longer they're there, they become a part of the problem, and they don't have that attitude that it's the people's money that they're spending. And, I mean, some of the idiotic things you see, we all see them. It just kind of amazes you, and it makes you want to stand up and yell. But I think if people focus more now like they have been on money being spent, I think the public is finally becoming aware of it. I think we may have turned the corner. The question is how quickly will it move, to another level? Churchill once described a monarchy as a big ocean liner in the waves, which could be sunk with a few holes in the hull. And he also said a democracy is like a raft in the waves. It'll never sink, but it really doesn't look very pretty. And that's, to me, probably the best description of our country compared to some others.
Well, Vern, we'd like to thank you for coming on the show. Could you give us your information in case anybody want to get a hold of you?
Sure. If you can send any donations, that would be very helpful to voteforvern.com. That's voteforvern.com. Again, I'm a small candidate, but any small donation would be very much appreciated. You'll get your money's worth.
Well, thank you, Vern. I want to thank you very much for answering my questions. I know sometimes I get a little deep. Everybody teases me. They call me a polywog, but I'm fascinated with government, and I want to see it fixed, and I think you were a great guest.
Well, I appreciate it, and I learned a lot, too.
Thank you, Vern. This is Steve Sanson and Jim Jonas. Until next week.
To the hills of Tennessee, across the plains of Texas, from sea to shining sea, from Detroit down to Houston.